All right, let us begin, please. We're going to get started to stay on track for this morning. Don't forget, of course, that we have this exciting event next Tuesday, which is our second test. Curb your enthusiasm. There will be a review section for that, indeed three of them, next Monday night, as we did last time. They'll be in room 207 of WLH again this Monday. 7, 8, and 9, respectively, and yours truly will be there. We'll also have Monday afternoon, if you want individual help, you can come to my office, and one of the TAs will be covering a run of about 4 or 5 hours there Monday afternoon, probably starting around 1 o'clock. And, of course, I'll be sending you a prep sheet on this so that you will know how to prepare for this test, just as we prepared for the last test. The test itself will be very similar to the first test, except when we get to the listening pieces, then we will not be so much concentrating on individual isolated aspects of melody, rhythm, and harmony, but these broader questions of form. What is the form? Where are we in the form? That's the essence of the assignment there. We're working here with form, and it's very important. It brings, I think, my guess is, in all of the listening that you've been doing, pop music, classical, whatever it is, how many, when you were listening, ever thought about form? Did you ever think about, even if you, okay, one person, I see Ray raised their hand, Robert, two, maybe Roger raises his hand, but not too enthusiastically. Yeah, it's the kind of thing that you could do a lot of playing and listening to music. You could take, as my 17-year-old, maybe 17, year old, maybe 12, 13 years of cello, and I could ask him, what form do we have, where are we in the form, and he wouldn't really know because he hasn't been exposed to that sort of thing. Well, it does help us. It's a whole dimension of listening that we can plug into, whether it's pop music and you're dealing with verse and chorus and bridge, or even, as we'll see today, ostinato in pop music, or in classical music, you plug in the form. Now, what are the six forms that we are going to be plugging in here? Somebody run us through our checklist. Roger, get us started, please. Oh, yeah, you can say one and then you pass the baton. Okay, sonata allegro, the most difficult, the biggest one. We spent the most time with that. What else? Chris? Fugue, we spent a lot of time with that. Fairly difficult. Daniel? Rondo, a little bit easier in the sense that you've got this one theme that kind of bludgeons you. You get a theme, then you get something else. Then that theme comes back, and then probably something else yet again. Then that theme comes back, and then something else again, and then theme, and so on. So you get the object, and then a lot of contrast, but the object keeps coming back. What else? Have we mentioned Chelsea? I'm sorry. Ternary form, yeah, that may be the easiest, kind of just the A-B-A idea. And we're missing one, I think. Yeah. Theme and variations. Your name, please? I'm sorry? Kristen. Okay, thanks very much, Kristen. So theme and variations is the last one. When you go to a concert, sometimes you can pick up the program, and here is a cover for a program that's going to serve as the makeup for our the makeup concert for our class. It's next Saturday, a week from Saturday, Jonathan Edwards Orchestra is going to be performing at Battelle. And they'll be doing the Beethoven 8th Symphony, And when you go there, you're going to have four movements in the Beethoven 8th Symphony. What's a good guess as to what form the first movement's going to be in? Sonata allegro, okay? Sonata allegro. Second movement, it could be in a number of different forms. What's a good guess for what the form of the third movement will be? Ternary form. It's going to be some kind of minuet, or perhaps scherzo. I think in this case, scherzo, trio, scherzo. That idea. Ternary form usually is the third movement of these four-movement symphony. And then the last movement, well, we'll have to sort of come to terms with that, figure that one out on the fly. And that's what we'll be doing on our test on Tuesday, although it will be a slow sort of lento fly there. We'll be going through it much more slowly than just one pass. So sometimes when listening, you've got to hear the music and make some kind of educated determination as to what the form is. And then you kind of, as I say, drop this template of that particular form down in your mind, and then filter the music thereafter through that model, be it the model of Sonata Allegro, or the model of Fugue, or the model of Rondo. You kind of hear the piece in that form thereafter. Questions about that? All right, if not, let's proceed with one final form today, which is ostinato. That's our sixth form. We haven't been introduced to that. We're going to do ostinato. But before we get to that, I want to recap one thing having to do with theme and variation form, because it allows us to bring in some of other things that we have been talking about. So it's a good culminating listening experience. And that is the finale of Beethoven's Eroica Symphony. Anybody know why it's called the Eroica Symphony? Who's the hero that's referenced there? Caroline? Napoleon, right. So Beethoven was working on the symphony. Napoleon was a hero. Then he gets word from Paris that Napoleon has had himself crowned emperor. He thinks, oh my God, Napoleon's just a tyrant like all the rest of them. So he's furious, and he scratches out on his score. And when you get to the Beethoven chapter of your textbook, look there. There's a photograph of the cover of the Eroica Symphony. And you can see the big hole where Beethoven, with his knife, scratched out Napoleon's name, and then later on he goes on to simply identify that as Symphony for a Hero, Symphony for a Hero, the Eroica Symphony. So that's what we mean by that particular term. The hero originally was to be Napoleon. So when we finish this exercise, when you finish this course, you will have actually been exposed to a number of Beethoven symphonies. We're talking about number 3 here. We opened with number 5. On the concert a week from Saturday, you'll have Beethoven 8, and those of you that went to the preceding concert are not barred from attending the one on the 1st of November. You too can get in the door there, so you might want to go to that, 7:30 in Battelle Chapel, November 1st. And the concert the other night, we had Beethoven 6, so you will have been exposed to 4 Beethoven symphonies here in this course, and that's pretty good for a beginning course. Great. All right, so let's talk about the finale here. And it's based on, and it's kind of fun, it's actually more complex than we would ever do on a test, but it's fun to work through it. It's based on 2 themes, based on 2 themes. So this is a set of variations using 2 themes. Beethoven liked to do this. He did this, actually, he did this in the slow movement of... What's that? What symphony is that? Anybody remember? Yeah, it was the Beethoven 6 that we had at the concert the other night with the woodwinds and all. And so on. That was the second theme. That was kind of the second, the B idea, if you will, of the 2 themes. So there, in the slow movement of Beethoven's 6th symphony, we had a double variation. And what we mean by double variation is simply that there are 2 themes in play. So here we have the 2 themes. One, the way he's constructed here, is in the treble. Nya ta ta tam pa tim pa tam pa pam 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 pa 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 pam pa tim. That's theme number 1. Here's theme number 2. Pam 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 pa ra pa 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 pam yam pam pam pam. So those are the 2 themes. So let's listen to some of this. It's going to start out with just a little bit of a curtain raiser. So I have a curtain raiser, and then one of the themes will come in. Which one does Beethoven start with? Up goes the curtain. Repeat. Continue. Repeat. Okay, we're going to stop it there. So which theme did he choose to work with here at the outset? Anybody know Daniel? Yeah, the bass theme. Bum, bing. And how was it being played? Wasn't it pizzicato? Bum, 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 bumps, it was the basic. All right, so that's, in a sense, we'll say, call that variation one. Let's go on with variation two here. Which theme does he choose to use at this point? Repeat. And repeat. Okay, so which theme is he using there? One or two? Yeah, Evgeny says two. And it was still the bass theme. It was a little bit harder to hear this time because it was being covered up above by some counterpoint. So we've got the theme, we've got counterpoint against it. Let's go on to variation number three. We'll see what happens. Which one here? Repeat. Going on. And repeat. So which theme this time? One or two? Still two. But he's moved it up into the first violin. He's moved it up higher, and he's got more sort of fast-running counterpoint against it. Let's go on to the next. We got to get number one at some point. Hooray. Stop it there and let's go back to that particular variation, if you will, please. I think it's at 154. What was the solo instrument there and how did he orchestrate this? Well, the first statement of this first theme, he assigned it to a solo instrument. Then, in the repeat, he had the strings take it over. Then that solo instrument came back, and then on the repeat, the strings took it over again. So it's an interesting use of orchestration here. Let's listen to this variation again, and what is the solo instrument up on top? Pause it there just for a second. So what's the solo instrument? Oboe. Yeah, so there's an oboe penetrating up on high. Question out there, Roger.
Yeah, can we think of this as like the kind of like the bar blues call and response kind of thing? Like using the different voices?
Yeah, I wouldn't want to take that too far, though. This is sort of an isolated event here where you do have a call and a response. And it does happen just in this one variation, but it's going to be limited to this one variation. Whereas in a Bessie Smith blues tune, you would have that call and response idea carried on throughout the entire composition. It's a good point, though. I hadn't thought of it in those terms, but that's it exactly. You got a call by the oboe and then a repeat of that idea. Maybe elaborated by the strings. So here we are up here, the solo oboe, and then we are going to have the response now by the string. So let's listen to that. Pause it here just for a second. Now something interesting happens. When we were dealing with sonata allegro form, we said that there were four functional types. And this, it really isn't just limited to sonata allegro form. There are functional types in all kinds of music. When you go to a movie, a cinema, a film, for example, oftentimes at the end of the scene, they will have a fade out. You know, and listen to the fade-out music. There's kind of transition music in film music a lot of times. Then maybe we get a new scene and it's very prominently displayed. Well, maybe we get thematic music at that particular point. So this idea of theme and transition, even development, can occur in all different kinds of music and all different kinds of contexts. But just to review that idea, we have thematic music, we have transitional music, we have developmental music. And again, it doesn't have to be limited to sonata allegro form. We saw developmental music in a section of the fugue called what? Anybody remember what we called that section of the fugue that was so developmental, Thaddeus? The episode. So there we, in the episode of the fugue, we have developmental activity. And we get ending cadential stuff virtually in every kind of music. So it's not limited just to sonata allegro form. But question here is, what is Beethoven writing at this particular particular point? Here we are in theme and variations, but I think we're referencing one of the four functional types of music in this next section. So what functional type is it? Okay, so what was that we just heard? What would you guess? Daniel? A transition. Yeah, he's just taking us very simply from point A to point B. And maybe just a little bit idea of a cadence. Transitions usually end with a couple of final sounding chords there at the end. So that's a transition. And we've moved. And we've moved from here, a major key. What would you imagine we're going to move to? A minor key, and it's probably, again, although we don't hear it, I don't hear it, we don't hear it, it's probably going to be the relative minor, because it's just simpler structurally to operate that way. So let's listen now to the next variation here. But something very interesting happens. He's referencing another form. He's incorporating another form in the composition as a variation. So what is the other form now? Stop it right there. So what form is he referencing? Michael?
Yes.
Got it right today. Okay. A fugue, yeah. And we, in just one hearing, it'd be hard to really know what voices would bring it in, but I'll just tell you, generally what he was doing there was starting up on the top. Okay, and then gradually coming down in terms of range. So it was soprano, alto, tenor, and then bass. And the bass did something interesting, which sort of reinforces a point we had the other day. The fugue subject that he's working with, which, by the way, so he's kind of varying that melody number one, kind of varying that melody. But when it gets to the bass, it does something interesting. Why is that interesting? What process do we have at work there that we talked about last time with regard to fugue? Anybody remember that, Daniel? Inversion. And I don't think I made that point clearly enough the other day. But anytime you have, well, you could have going up a minor third and then down a second. You could go down a minor third and then up a second. So you're just turning the intervals and a kind of a mirror image there. So here Beethoven uses a little bit of inversion. So in the middle of this theme and variation movement, he inserts a fugue. And a fugue inserted inside another form is called a Fugato, fugato. So here, as the fourth, I think, fifth variation of this last movement, he inserts a fugato. Let's skip, if you would please, Linda, all the way up to about 800. We're going to listen to one final variation here, and we, at this point, we want to concentrate on the duration of the melody. We were starting out ya-ta-ta-tam, pa-tim-pa-tam, ta-tam-pam-pam. One, two, one, two, in that fashion. What's Beethoven doing here? Almost there? Yeah, it's a long way to go. Here we go. Pause it there just for a second. So what's he done here to his melody, to the duration within his melody? It's now, can you express it? If we were coming, yam, pam, 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 and now we're going, pam, 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 pam. What's he doing? Well, come on, I just hear little, small little words out there. Somebody, let's choose somebody who's pretty confident, and that person will yell it out. Marcos? I'm sorry, I didn't hear that. That's the psychological effect of retardando, slowing it down, giving you a sense you're getting to the end. But once again, technically, that's not exactly what he's doing. He's giving that effect by doing something. That is? Right, he's changing the note values. He's simply doubling the note values. And when we do that in music, we call that augmentation. Sometimes when we get to Hector Berlioz, we'll see diminution. To give a sense of urgency to the music, you can chop them all in half. Well, here he's getting toward the end. He wants this grand, broad effect. He's brought in the brasses. It's showtime. So what does he do? He doubles all of the note values in theme number one. So let's continue, please. And then he sort of fades out and adds a little coda at that point. But that's the way we end the third symphony, the Eroica symphony of Beethoven. So it's an interesting piece because it's got a fugato in there. It's got sections that sound like transition out of sonata allegro form. And he's working with two themes. Questions about that before we move on? All right, so let's put that behind us now and go on to talk about ostinato form. Once again, we've been through this many times, but what is an ostinato? Okay, I know it's embarrassing. It's something that happens again and again and again. It's sort of obsessive compulsive disorder applied to music, okay? Obsessive compulsive disorder applied to music. The most famous example of this is probably the... the bolero of Maurice Ravel. So we put that up on the board here as our first ostinato piece, 1928, piece from the 20th century. It's ostinato in every way, in the sense that the melody keeps repeating over and over again for 14 minutes. The rhythm, that keeps going for 14 minutes and change, depending upon the tempo of the conductor. And when we did this, remember, you guys were providing the bass harmony, bum, 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 and that's all you do for 14 minutes and 30 seconds. So every aspect of that, melody, rhythm, and harmony, is controlled by this ostinato procedure. And in its example, as mentioned, from the 20th century. But the heyday of ostinato form, really in two periods in the history of music. One in the Baroque period, and two, right now. Right now, because when you start listening to your pop music, go out there and listen to those bass and start charting those basses and see how repetitious they are. When Frederick Evans brought in that piece of In Sync or whatever it was that he brought in, and I started listening to that, I said, my God, he's got a descending tetrachord bass, ostinato, embedded in that. Now, I'm sure Frederick didn't sit there scratching, oh yes, there's my descending tetrachord, chromatic descending tetrachord bass there, but it's in there. It's embedded in so much of this popular music, and that's kind of what we're going to track here a little bit, but we're going to start with the Baroque. So we could start with who's the best, we could even say the best composer of the Baroque. Well, J.S. Bach. So let's start with an organ piece of Bach, and we'll listen to an ostinato bass. Generally speaking, in music, when you get an ostinato, it's applied to the bass. It sets up a repeating harmony. So that's what we got here. So here's a Passacaglia, just a little bit of it by Bach. You can see what he's doing once he gets his bass in there, and it's a typical 8-bar pattern. It's odd how many of these ostinato basses are in 8-bar units. So it's an 8-bar pattern here with Bach. Then all he does is keep throwing over top of that different rhythmic patterns and slightly different melodic patterns as well. But that bass, ya ti ta tam pa di ta tam pa di 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 bi bim pom, keeps churning away over and over underneath in that piece for what instrument by Bach? Organ, big, powerful pipe organ there. Wonderful, wonderful sound. All right, so that's an introduction to the basso ostinato, the ostinato bass, by Bach. Let's turn to some music now of Henry Purcell. Henry Purcell was an English composer working in London at the end of the 17th century. He was employed by, must have been James II, and then I think William and Mary for a little bit. So he wrote for the court, and he also wrote for the theater. And in one instance, it turned out to be his most famous composition, he wrote an opera for an all-girls boarding school in the London suburb of Chelsea. I guess it's now part of downtown London. There's a famous soccer team, Chelsea something, I don't know. You see him on TV. So there's Henry Purcell out at this all-girl boarding school, and annually they put on a drama. So it was kind of like the senior class play, and all of the roles were sung by women, except in this case, one role was sung by a male, and that was the role of Aeneas. So we've got the famous story of Dido and Aeneas. You've probably read it in literature classes. You've probably read parts of it in Latin. It's from book 4, and it used to be in a really good secondary type education when you're doing Latin, you've had maybe 6 or 7 years of Latin, you would read the Virgil's Aeneid in the original Latin. Anybody do that in your, wow, holy schmoly, Latin is making a serious comeback here, because it's not easy. It's not easy stuff. It's traditional classical Latin, where the syntax is radically different than medieval Latin or any kind of modern language. Okay, well, good for you guys. So you know the story. Somebody tell me the story then. Michael, what's the story? Okay, so Aeneas has to leave for another country. It happens to be what country? Yeah, he's got to follow his destiny and go off and found the city of Rome, and in the vernacular, having ditched Dido back in Carthage. She's not happy about this. She dies, depending upon the theatrical version or the original. She either stabs herself, falls on a burning funeral pyre, or dies of a broken heart. But this is opera, so you know that at the end of it, the soprano's got to die, right? This is the way operas die. Operas end, die, dead. So anyway, you could do Violetta in Traviata, you could do Tosca in Tosca. We've even seen here the Liebestod at the end of Wagner's Tristan. Isolde dies after singing the Liebestod, expires there. So it's a convention of opera. And in this particular opera, we have a famous aria. It's called Dido's Lament, where she is lamenting the fact that she has been abandoned by Aeneas. And it's interesting because it's built on an ostinato bass line. And it's built on an ostinato bass line that descends. And this is important because it became a convention for lamentation. So this is the bass line for Dido's lament here. Ya ti 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 da ta ta boom boom ya ti da tim da tim di ta ta boom boom, and it just keeps recycling like over and over and over again. That's the ostinato. And then up above it, we have the lamentation. When I am laid in earth, may my wrongs create no trouble in thy breast. Remember me, but ah, forget my fate. So that's what she's singing. So let's listen to a bit of this. And before we do that, we have the term on the board up there, ground bass. All that is the English term for ostinato bass. Ground bass, ostinato bass, the same thing. But it gives us the sense, at least, that the bass grounds. It kind of holds together. It's the foundation for the entire composition. So let's listen. We'll start with the ground bass, nice and loud here, Linda, please. And then the singer will come in. Stop it there. So that's how this plays out, and that bass keeps cycling through the duration of this particular aria. Listening to this recording gives us the opportunity to think about approaches to music. This is a piece written at the end of the 17th century, and actually in this particular recording they're playing this and singing in a way that would be rather similar to the way they would have done it in the 17th century. They have reproductions of 17th century instruments. And the singer here is trying to create a particular approach vocally to the music. So as we listen to this recording one more time, we're going to hear just a little bit more of it, and then we're going to ask you to compare this recording to another recording. This would be the kind of thing that a reviewer would do. So let's listen to a bit more of this recording A, we'll call it, and then we'll move on. Let's pause it there. Now we're going to go on to recording B. So what's the difference here in approach, in terms of orchestra, everything, voice, in how does recording B differ from recording A? Thank you. maybe we'll pause it there. What's your reaction to that? How do those two differ? Hands, please, Caroline. Okay, First Singer had a much more youthful approach. And you could see that as an attempt to maybe duplicate the performance context of the original performance in a high school, a girls' school there in late 17th century London. More specifically, what about the quality of that voice? Any thoughts? Roger? Okay, now, so we have the two recordings. Which of the two had more vibrato, one or two? Two had a lot more vibrato. So that's really the big difference here, that one was a very well-focused voice with very little vibrato, and maybe that's what gave it this youthful appeal. It's almost like the voice of a choir boy or a choir girl, for heaven's sakes, a pre-adolescent child, but intending to make it very pure and very, very clean and very well-focused. The second recording, what that might be a recording that you would expect to hear, performance you would expect to hear where? Maybe in a modern opera theater or an opera hall, a hall designed for opera, where we've got this huge expanse that we have to fill. What about the orchestra? Frederick? You mean higher in terms of pitch?
Yes.
Frederick, you have a very good ear. Actually, that's true. I don't want to get into this, but the first recording is pitched in F sharp in the old Baroque tuning. They're trying to really be so authentic. Pitch in the Baroque era was actually lower than it is today. We know that because there are tuning forks that survived from that period that got labeled on it A. You play that A, and it turns out to be our G sharp. So aficionados of this particular repertoire, when they go to perform Baroque music, they're going to use reproductions of authentic instruments, they're going to use non-vibrato singing, and they're going to use the lower pitch. I didn't plan on getting into that, but since you picked up on it, good for you. Now, we don't have to hear that, and to be honest with you, the only reason I remembered that was I went to duplicate it before coming in here today. I went to duplicate those pitches on the piano so I'd be up to speed with this, and I realized, Jesus, I'd have to do this in F sharp, and that's going to require some quick transposition up here because I can do it quickly in G with only two flats, but F sharp, well, how many sharps I got there, and I had to figure all of this out. So, but that is going on there. That's an interesting development. Yeah. Anything else? What about the tempo of the two? Size of the orchestra always determines to some degree the tempo. Oscar? Yeah, the second recording was much slower. I was intentionally trying to beat it up here, and it was a very labored beat pattern. It was much slower because they had many more instruments, a lot more people playing. Axiomatic, the more people you have, the longer it takes for sound to clear, the slower your tempo will go, unless you have a maniacally dictatorial type of conductor that will really push you. So it leads to the more people, the slower the tempo is going to go. So what we have here is a reproduction of an attempt to reproduce authentic 17th century performance as opposed to a modern performance, big sound, metropolitan opera type of sound. All right. Let's move on here. One interesting aspect of this, I discovered this driving down Whitney Avenue. This is true. Driving down Whitney Avenue one day, I must have been fishing for 91.5 on my FM dial and suddenly had a seizure or something and I didn't quite make it and I was listening to Elton John. Okay, listening to Elton John, and what did I hear but the craziest thing? What I heard was this text, it's sad, it's sad, it's a sad, sad situation, and then I heard, yum, pim, da, ti, ta, ti, da, ti, dum, boom, boom. I said, whoa, wait a minute there, that's the Purcell bass line. That's the Purcell bass line. Elton John has stolen the person baseline. Arrest that man. No. We don't do this because, as we say, these baselines are in the common domain. As we have said before, you can't sue anybody for the theft of a baseline. And indeed, it was all over the place in the Baroque. This is a type of, it became a kind of musical icon. Anytime an audience would hear, they would think death or bad news. And actually, we still do today. It doesn't hit the road, Jack, based on that same kind of ostinato bass. But in the Baroque, you could go back to Monteverdi's Lamenta della Ninfa. You could go to Bach's cantata Weinenklagen, Sorgen, Sagen, to whine, kvetch. You could go to the Crucifixus, the Bach B minor mass. What could be more painful or dispiriting than a crucifixion? So this was a moniker. It was a kind of emblem of lamentation, whether it's in Purcell, whether it's in Bach, or whether it's in Elton John. So what Elton John was to take this, and he used it not at the beginning of this piece, sorry is the saddest, or sorry is the hardest word to say. He didn't use it at the beginning, he used it in the chorus. So here we are in the chorus of Elton John's, I think it's sorry is the saddest thing to say, or something like that. The hardest word, it's sad, so sad, with the sad, sad situation, and it's getting more and more absurd. So sad, why can't we talk it over? Oh, it seems to me that sorry seems to be the hardest word. And then he goes on with the next verse. Okay, so that's just one example of a use of that particular ostinato bass. We actually call that a lament bass, and Mozart even did it. He wrote a violin sonata on the occasion of his mother's death in E minor, and he has that thing just going down the descending. Basically, it's this descending tetrachord here that gets filled in chromatically. All right, so we've got that as an ostinato bass. What's the most famous ostinato bass of all time, Baroque or modern? The Pachelbel bass, okay? And we've got this thing called the Pachelbel canon. Do you have the Xerox for today? What's the Pachelbel canon? Well, we've worked a little bit with this. I think it was listening exercise 8, I believe, early on in the course, where we were trying to have you focus on changing harmonies. And these harmonies are just generated by this repeating bass line. There's an irony with the Pachelbel canon, and that is that you never hear the canon in the Pachelbel canon. Why is that the case? It's because if you look, he's got these three canonic lines, the three staves up above, all in the same register. And when people record this, they always do it with the same instrument, usually just with the violin. So we have the violins up above, three violins all playing in the same register. You can't pick out the canon. It just sounds like this unfolding jumble. It's a very beautiful jumble, but it's indistinctive in that sense. Maybe if they orchestrated oboe, flute, and clarinet, maybe we could hear the canon better. What we hear, of course, grinding away underneath is the ostinato bass. So let's listen to just a bit of this. And I was struck the other day when I went back and listened to this recording on your CDs, they have put in this something that's actually Pachelbel didn't write. When this starts out, they just start with a... What's that? It's a descending major scale. So they just say, all right, here's your basic tonality, here's your tonal grid or whatever. So let's listen to the bass start out, then we'll have this descending scale that Pachelbel didn't write, and then his canon will start. And you can see how this works here. I've indicated A gets repeated as B comes in and so on. It's pretty straightforward how the canon operates. Okay, here comes the scale now. Mm-hmm. now the canon starts. A1. Second voice comes in. First voice goes on to present something new. B. It here now. We're going to pause it here. It goes for about 4 minutes. It's very beautiful. It's lovely, 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 lovely. But you know this bass line, right? Okay, so there's our D. Let's all sing it together. Ready, sing. Da, 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 da. Okay, so once you get that in your ear, you have a sense, it's really in there, and that you may have heard that many different times before. Now, lots of people made use of the Pachelbel canon, and I know of at least three and maybe four that I've put up on the board up there. And you may know of more. Marcos sent me a YouTube clip of a comedian. Maybe you guys have seen this. What was the comedian's name? He was sort of so sick of the Pachelbel canon because every piece he picks up has got the baseline of the Pachelbel canon in it. What comedian was that? Doesn't matter. Okay. So those are my four. Anybody else know where else they show up? All right, well, let's review. Thaddeus, good. Britney Spears has the Pachelbel canon? What a time to be alive. Wow. All right. Thaddeus, go get that for me. I need this one. This is gold. Thank you very much. But check it. For example, one of the students, Daniel in here, gave me, and we talked about it, let's go to that one. Let's go to that one. It would be CD4, track 2 at about 020. He said, this may be a knockoff of the Pachelbel canon. It's called the Taco Bell canon. So let's see if the Pachelbel canon is in fact embedded in the Taco Bell canon here. Pachelbel bass? Is that the pattern you were singing? Yes or no? I mean, think yes, raise your right hand. I mean, think no, raise your left hand. No, it ain't the Pachelbel canon. Is it an ostinato bass? Yes, it's an ostinato bass. So we could keep playing with that. I could play you Coolio, Blues Traveler, Vitamin C. Just for a laugh, let's do Vitamin C, which is CD 2, track 1. And I'm sorry about this, but it's too good to pass up. Okay, so out you go. Thanks for your attention. Appropriately enough, it's in the key of C. Vitamin C, C.